Hi, I am Kemit-Amon Lewis, the Coral Conservation Manager for the Nature Conservancy's Caribbean Program. I lead the coral reef conservation and restoration work across the Caribbean region, developing strategies and best practices for coral restoration, as well as initiatives to better understand and reduce or eliminate threats to coral reefs. I'm 34 years old, and in that relatively short period of time, I have seen many things changed. I remember growing up on the small Caribbean island of St. Croix in the U.S. Virgin Islands and snorkeling at my favorite beach every day for every summer that I can remember. I recall the vibrant colors and abundance of life on the reefs. Those many childhood adventures have definitely defined my career path from a very young age. In high school, I was a marine science student. We received scuba certification and had a scuba club that allowed us to dive even deeper into the field, creating a better understanding and appreciation for life underwater. Cane Bay was our favorite site. We were fascinated about the world's famous wall at Cane Bay, an underwater cliff close to shore that dropped vertically to over 3,000 feet. There was so much life to see underwater, and as much as the sharks, rays, turtles, and huge schools of fish were impressive, the variety, abundance, and structural complexity of the coral reefs were equally remarkable. But things have changed. Today, I enjoy the memories of Cane Bay before the summer of 2005. That summer, we observed severe and widespread coral bleaching across the island, across the Caribbean, and across the globe. And while there was coral bleaching observed globally in 1998, 2005 was a particularly bad year for us at home. Large 100-year-old colonies of corals were bleached, and many of them did not recover and eventually died. Corals are animals that live in a mutually beneficial relationship with zooxanthellae, a tiny photosynthetic plankton. Zooxanthellae live in the tissue of corals, and in return, zooxanthellae provide food to the corals. Because zooxanthellae are pigmented, they also give corals a colored appearance. You can think of the relationship as a landlord and tenant relationship. When stressed, corals, the landlord, will evict their zooxanthellae tenant in an effort to conserve energy. When the zooxanthellae are ejected, we are able to see through the colorless coral tissue onto the white calcium carbonate skeleton that the corals grow. As a result, coral colonies appear bright white or bleached when they are under stress. Coral bleaching typically occurs during extreme warm water events and is a result of elevated sea surface temperatures combined with light intensity. If conditions return to normal within a few short weeks, corals may recover. However, if the sea surface temperatures stay above normal for extended periods of time, the corals may die. In some instances, even if corals recover, the stress of the bleaching event may weaken the corals so much that they become more susceptible to diseases and other stressors. Climate change is increasing the risk of coral bleaching worldwide. In recent years, places like Florida, Belize, Hawaii, Guam, Palau, and Australia have all recorded coral bleaching events in consecutive years. In some sites like on St. Croix in 2005, up to 95% of the corals were impacted by the bleaching events and may have died. The fact of the matter is, our summers are warmer than they have been in our lifetime and are expected to get warmer in the future. Scientists at the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration have been tracking rising sea surface temperatures for years now, and their models project that by the year 2050, temperatures will be consistently over the bleaching threshold on an annual basis. In addition to warmer waters, which causes coral bleaching, more carbon dioxide is being absorbed by our oceans. Increased carbon dioxide concentrations causes a decrease in the ocean's pH. In other words, our oceans are becoming more acidic. An acidic ocean makes it harder and will eventually make it impossible for shelled organisms to build their shells and for coral reefs to build their skeletons. Unfortunately for us, because so many of these organisms provide the building blocks of the ocean's food web, a loss of them is equivalent to a loss of most, if not all, of the marine life that sustains coastal communities and economies worldwide. And when you add sea level rise to the equation, it may seem that our oceans and our Caribbean islands are in serious trouble. While the Caribbean is known for our white sandy beaches and breathtaking coastal habitats, they are beginning to disappear as the warming of our seas also translates to rising sea levels. a combination of thermal expansion, where water expands as it is heated, as well as melting ice from our polar regions, are causing this loss of coastal habitat, and in some islands, this is happening at alarming rates. In Grenada, for example, the Nature Conservancy has been tracking the loss of the coast of Grenville, a small fishing village on the windward coast of Grenada. Each year, Grenville Bay loses about 2 feet of its coast to sea level rise. In recent years, we have had more cases of tropical systems crossing the Caribbean annually, and some of the strongest hurricanes on record. With these systems, we observe more flooding, as well as a loss in life and property associated with these strong hurricanes. And of course, there are the impacts to coral reefs from soil washing into the ocean and physical damage caused by waves in these hurricanes. So yes, the impacts of climate change are very concerning for coastal communities, but there is hope for our future. For decades, the Nature Conservancy has been focused on building hope for the future of our reefs, our oceans, our coasts, and of our Caribbean way of life. And the future has never seemed brighter.